Good morning. I love that song. But several different ways of looking at this, and one of the most popular that I've seen accepted because it just sat wrong with me was that God would rather have mercy on you than you do sacrifices. In other words, don't worry about doing sacrifices. This is what Jesus is telling the people. Don't worry about the sacrifices of the Old Testament. Just worry about grace. I know that that's not the case, but that's what a lot of people have taught this to mean. God would rather be merciful to you than to receive. He has that desire, but that's not what this means. And if you've been thinking about that, I hope you'll think through it with me this morning as we look at it. Go and learn what this means. Now, I put a warning here on here, a warning label. You might need to chew on this for a little while. And I say that not because I'm so much more intelligent than you. I had to chew on it for a while myself. And I'm suspecting that you might have to think about it too, especially if you haven't really considered it before. Or if you already think the way that I mentioned just now. But this can be a complicated idea. It's complicated, one, and yet at the same time, it's so complex that it doesn't matter if you're a babe in Christ or you've been a veteran for 60 years, you can still get something out of what he said. It's amazing what he did and how he taught. That's another lesson in and of itself. But think about this and chew on it a little bit. And you may not agree with everything I say, but I hope that we can come to an understanding of the same scriptures. I want you first of all, take a look at where this comes from. Anytime you see a passage in the New Testament and you notice that it's a quotation of the Old Testament, the temptation is to see it at face value and say, I understand that, I understand the concept, and so I just move on, or I can understand it in that text. And sometimes you don't have time to really go back and research the background of it, but anytime you're studying the Word and a quotation from the Old Testament is used in the New Testament, always go check that if you can. And the reason is because you'll see that Jesus and the apostles, the people that wrote the New Testament, they always quoted everything in context. Now, I say that with the understanding that there are people today that teach that Jesus took things out of context and used them in his own way. There are people that actually say that the apostles did the same thing. They call it proof texting. And they say, we shouldn't do that, but even though the apostles and Jesus did that. I'm here to tell you, Jesus never proof texted anything. He never just went in and found words that said what he wanted to say, forgot the context, just removed the words completely and said, hey, this is what Isaiah said, or this is what Hosea said. He didn't do that. Every time he pulled out of the Old Testament, he always kept it in the context. And so if you understand the context of it, you're going to see a nuance that an understanding in the New Testament. It may even changed its meaning because there's a new covenant now, but always start with what they taught, what they believed. Your influence will be determined by understanding and choosing the mindset of mercy over sacrifice. And this is what we're going to, I'm hoping that you will take away from this. So look at what he says here. Hosea chapter 6 and verse 6, he says, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings. Now if you'll back up a few verses to help get the context, he says in verse 4, O Ephraim, what shall I do to you? O Judah, what shall I do? Therefore, I've hewn them by the prophets. I've slain them by the words of my mouth, and your judgments are like light that goes forth. For I desire mercy and not sacrifice. Now, to help us understand the context, we need to understand that this is a call to them to repent. And he's rebuking them because, as he says in verse 4, in the middle, your faithfulness is like a cloud, and like the early dew, it goes away. So you're faithful for a very short time, and what happens when you're, after that short time, you go back into doing what you're doing? How would that happen? The reason is because they would come to a point where they would recognize that they needed to repent. You can think of the time of the judges as an example of this. They would have, things were going well because they're right with God, and then they would take that for granted, and they would start sinning. And as soon as they started sinning, they would be oppressed by other people, and then they would recognize, sometimes it took a long time, the oppression, and they would call out to God, and they would start coming back to him, and then he would send a man or a woman to save them from their situation, and then they would be right back in standing with God, only to do the same thing again. So their righteousness was like a fog. It's like at early morning when you wake up and you see a fog and it's gone by noon, right? That's what he's saying to them. He says, this is what I want from you, though. I desire mercy and not sacrifice. And the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings. The knowledge of God, there's an indication, a key to help us understand what the first part of that verse means. It literally means, when he says, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, the word mercy there literally means loving kindness. And it literally means loving kindness toward God. I want loving kindness toward me. That's what he says, not sacrifice. And we put it that way, it should come in, maybe even lock in, say, I get it now. When I started realizing what that word was, it's hesed in the Hebrew, and I don't think I'm saying it correctly, but H-E-S-E-D, look it up. Guilty or faithfulness to God. And some translations have even put that word in there. It's in a footnote in mine. When I first read that, I thought, how is mercy and faithfulness the same? Because loving kindness is directed toward God. You see how that could be loyal? If I'm loyal to God, it's because I have loving kindness toward him. I love him. That's the reason that they were taught to love the Lord God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength. That's why Jesus taught that same thing as the greatest commandment. Mercy here is what he wants. Now think about this, what it means then when he says, I desire mercy and not sacrifice. I desire that you love me, not that you make sacrifices. Well, that's pretty easy to get, isn't it? It's like when you tell your children, I don't want to punish you. I want you to do what's right. I want us to have a good relationship together. I want to trust you. I want to love you. I want to dote on you and pour things out to you, right? I want to have a good relationship. A relationship is not based on how much you punish a person, right? God doesn't want to punish us. We don't live so that he can inflict pain and punishment upon us. He wants us to have a relationship with him. He wants us to love him. The thing that I noticed when I was studying through the parable of the sower in Mark chapter 4 was that in the parable, he talked about the four different soils. But in the parable, in the second soil, I believe it was the second one, he said that the soil was the rocky soil. I'd always said that means that you need to dig into the Word and dig and understand everything you can about the Word, but that's not actually what he said. He said the seed is the Word of God. The seed is what digs into the heart. So the seed, the Word of God, has to have a taproot that goes into the heart. And the deeper it goes into you, into your heart, into your soul, into the seed of who you are, the more likely it is that you're going to produce fruit to God. You can have all the knowledge in the world. You can plumb the depths of this and pick out so much more than anybody else could. That's a possibility. You can understand everything about the Bible, the Word of God, but that does not mean you're going to be faithful. What that means is you have knowledge. But if I penetrate the Word, but the Word never penetrates me, you see, that's the problem. It's like one of the Russian dictators, and I just went blank on his name, but he had Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John memorized as a child, and he kept it his entire life. He could quote to you chapters after chapter after chapter of the Bible, and yet he didn't even believe in God. You see, he penetrated the Word, but the Word did not penetrate him. And this is what it means when we're talking about what God's Word does to us. We have to have that root that burrows down into our hearts. We have to have that connection. And this relates to our mind, our body, our soul, our spirit, the seed of our emotions, everything that all of our being must be in relationship to this. That mercy here then means faithfulness. If I have that loving kindness toward God, I don't rely on a relationship of sacrifices in order to be right with him. Now, does that mean that sacrifices are null and void? No, they were necessary. The sacrifice of Jesus is absolutely necessary. Why? Because I sin from time to time. But there's a lot different to say that than it is to say, I rely on sacrifices because I just can't help it. I just sin all the time. I can't go 30 minutes without sinning. Why? How is that even possible? The only reason that would be possible, you can't go 3 seconds without sinning. The only reason that would be possible is if your dedication is not toward God. If your heart is right with God, if you're seeking to please him, if you love him with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength, you can avoid sin for a little while. Okay, you may have some difficulties. I have difficulties too. But our relationship is not on how much of a sacrifice, how many sacrifices I make. My relationship is how much I love God. This is what he wants. This is what he said. I desire mercy and not sacrifice. So the Jews at this point relied upon him to take care of them. This is what's going on in the book of Hosea. They relied upon God to take care of him, and they would wait for times to get bad, and then they would start doing sacrifices because they think, well, okay, this is what God wants. I'm going to do sacrifices, and then everything will be good again. It's kind of like pushing a button, you know. I need something, so I'm going to go pray to God now. I'm going to pray to him because I'm having a difficult time in life. Okay, I'm going to pray to him now. Is it wrong to pray to him when we have difficulties? No, he wants us to. But if that's the extent of our relationship with him, we actually don't love God. We love what he can do for us. So he desires to have mercy and not sacrifice. Now think about that as we look in Matthew chapter 9. Keep that in mind. Because in Matthew chapter 9, this is the first place we see that Jesus actually used this quotation. And this quotation is also used in other places in the New Testament, but I think Jesus only used it twice. Chapter 9 and verse 10, it says, "Now it happened as Jesus sat at the table in the house that, behold, many tax collectors and sinners came and sat down with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw it, they said to his disciples, 'Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?' When Jesus heard that, he said to them, 'Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice. For I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance.'" Now, think through about this. Think about the context of what we just talked about with the mindset and good things happen to me. It's very, very superstitious. By the way, have you, men, if you have the attitude that you can do whatever you want to do in your life towards your wife or just in general, and if she doesn't like it, she happens to get upset, your first automatic reaction is not to understand the situation, but just go buy flowers. Everything I do, it's a relationship based on, I'm buying flowers for my wife. Why are you buying flowers for my wife? I don't know. I'm sure I did something wrong. Is that a good relationship? That's not a relationship. It's a relationship based on flowers, right? I mean, it's shallow. So we understand this from a perspective. Sometimes we don't want his people to be loyal to him. Everyone knows that. Not just to make sacrifices to overcome guilt. Are sacrifices necessary? They were in the Old Testament. The sacrifice of Jesus, absolutely necessary. We have to have the sacrifice of Jesus. But that's not what everything is about. It's not about guilt. It's about a relationship, the love that I have for him. The Pharisees would never teach these people how to properly live the law. This is what we have an indication here of what he says. In chapter 10, in verse 19, chapter 9, in verse 11, when the Pharisees saw it, they said to his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" Now, if a tax collector or a sinner came and asked a question of the Pharisees, they might take the time to give them an answer, but they surely weren't going to sit down and eat with them. They surely weren't going to spend any time at all with them. And so this is a very important part of this situation that Jesus is in. They're condemning Jesus because he's taking time to deal with people who are sinners, who are despicable. They want nothing to, this Jewish elite wanted nothing to do with them. Okay, so as we think about this then, if these people have never learned about how to live the law, the only thing you could expect is that they would make sacrifice after sacrifice to God. They never learned how to serve him. They never learned how to please him. They never learned what it took to stay on his good side, so to speak. The only thing they learned was, I need to rely on the law of I need to rely on the blood of these bulls and goats to make me right with God. So I appease God by making sacrifices. And even then, they may not have even learned that. They may not have even made a sacrifice. It could be that instead of making sacrifices, they just depend on the high priest who once a year goes in and makes atonement for the entire nation. That could have been all that they were dependent on. Why? Because they didn't know any better. They weren't taught. If they were never allowed to even be around the Jewish elite, how could they ever learned what the Bible says, or what the Old Testament says? That's something to consider. We also see that they would need to rely on the sacrifices, like I said, of the yearly sacrifice of the high priest. So their relationship with God was all about making sure all the proper sacrifices were made. But this is not what God intended for them. We also recognize from this and other passages that this is a heart issue. Our relationship with God, service to God, is always about our heart. He doesn't need our sacrifices. What he needs is us. What he wants is us. And these people, these tax collectors and sinners, they were doomed. The only interaction they had, the blood of bulls and goats, do not take away sin. But if our relationship with God is based purely on a sacrificial system, then we're going to be in trouble. That gets us to the point of where we start worrying, is there something in my life that I did and I forgot to ask for forgiveness for it? See, those kinds of questions start coming up when I start thinking, am I making enough sacrifices? My relationship with God is not based on that. It's based on the love that he has for me and the love that I have for him. That's why the most important command is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Does that mean that we never ask for forgiveness? Absolutely not. Ask for forgiveness. You need to. But that's not the basis of it. So let's think about this in application for us. Do we approach people to help them produce loyalty to God? If you think about this from a perspective of evangelism, is our approach to people, is it primarily to get them to love and serve God? Or do we approach them relative to overcoming guilt? You think about that based on the questions that you might ask someone. You talk to someone, and it could be that you're trying to convince them of their need for Jesus, and I appreciate this, and it could be that we focus on sin and guilt of sin, and there's nothing wrong with that. But if we're not careful, it could be all about coming to someone, proving they're guilty of sin, and showing this is the sacrifice that Jesus made for you so you can overcome guilt, and that's it. Is that everything? No. Because once they become a Christian, we have the top part of that too. If we teach people, if our focus is that they be loyal and loving toward God, we have the plan of salvation that we have mapped out pretty well. I understand, and it's great. You hear the word of God, confession before men, and you're baptized for the remission of your sins, and then also, of course, you remain faithful. Those are all wonderful things that need to be taught to everyone, but we're missing one there. There's not one place in there, in those five steps, that says love God. Now, you could say all of them are a result of loving God. Yes, that's true. But why not emphasize the fact that people need to be loyal to love God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength? I tell you what, if people learn to love God and they see sin in their lives, what are they going to want to do? They're going to get rid of it. Why? Because they love God. They want to be with him. They want a relationship. They want to be in heaven with him one day. Not always, not just because I feel guilty about sin, but also because I love God. I want to be with him. So this is the emphasis that he puts on them. The Pharisees, I think this will be borne out a little bit more as we see the next part of this. The Pharisees had a very bad misunderstanding about how the law worked. Look in Matthew chapter 12. Remember, this is a passage that where Jesus' disciples were doing nothing wrong. They were walking through a field, which they were allowed to do, and they were taking of the grain in their own hand. The law of Moses actually said this was allowed. This was actually allowed by God. But it happened to be on the Sabbath. And some Jews decided that they wanted to interpret the law to mean that we knew that on the Sabbath they had to rest from their labors. And one of the labors that was very common was harvesting, right? So farming. So you spend a lot of time, it's a job to harvest a crop. And they try to define it. So they trying to protect people from, so that they wouldn't be guilty of sin. They invented this law that said you can't even take grain and rub it together in your hands and eat it because that's harvesting. That's not harvesting. That's not a job. That's not working. But this is how they interpreted it. So the apostles went through, they grabbed some grain, and they ate it. And the Pharisees said, why do your disciples do this? Look at where he says in verse 2, When the Pharisees saw it, they said to him, "Look, your disciples are doing what is not lawful to do on the Sabbath." But he said to them, "Have you not read what David did when he was hungry, he and those who were with him? How he entered the house of God and ate the showbread, which was not lawful for him to eat, nor of those who were with him, but for only for the priests? That in this place there is one greater than the temple. But if you had known what this means, 'I desire mercy, not sacrifice,' you would not have condemned the guiltless. For the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." Commonly explained, this passage, people have said that this means that God's okay with it. You can do something wrong. It's a little thing. It doesn't matter. That actually abuses so many ideas in the Bible. God always cares about sin. His point is not that when he says, "I desire mercy, not sacrifice," let's just be merciful to them. Don't worry about if they just do little minor things. Because look at what David did, and that was okay. Look how they profane the Sabbath. Every Saturday, they're in there making sacrifices. That's work. That's profaning the Sabbath. But actually, that's not what he's saying at all. In fact, what he says about what David did with the showbread, you'll have to go look that up to explain. I'm not going to go into it. But what he did with the showbread, he said that was not lawful. He even said it wasn't lawful. It was not something they should have done, that he should have done. And in fact, when he says that they should have understood that here is a man they put on a pedestal, David, and he did something wrong that they were okay with. And yet they're condemning someone who's done nothing wrong because of some invention that they had. And then also, if he says profaning the Sabbath, when they're making sacrifices and profaning the Sabbath, are they actually profaning the Sabbath? No. God specifically told them to do those things. How can you obey God and profane the Sabbath at the same time? Obviously, there's an exception to that. The exception to the Sabbath rule was the priests had to make sacrifices. They had to do that every day. So they weren't doing anything wrong. Jesus is saying the same thing with them. These people are not doing wrong. But here's your problem, Pharisees. Here's your problem. You don't understand what it means where he says, "I desire mercy and not sacrifice." So let's think about that. The Pharisees had just condemned the apostles for eating grain. Jesus taught they shouldn't mistreat others by placing hypocritical burdens on them. That's basically what he's saying here. You're being hypocritical. Don't put burdens on them that are undue. But let's clarify it a little bit more. First of all, the Pharisees invented ways for people to be wrong. Do you realize that? They created all these laws, hundreds and hundreds of laws, just to keep people from breaking one of the laws of Moses. Instead of worrying about breaking the law of Moses, they worried about them breaking their own laws. And they were hedges. They were to keep people from breaking the law. So they created this law about the Sabbath, how you couldn't pick up grain and harvest it, because that's violating. If you violate this law, then you may be violating the law of Moses later on. So you can't do that. So they created all these laws to protect the people, so to speak. And actually, all they were doing was inventing ways to condemn other people. That's all they were doing. They were inventing ways, things that could you just couldn't keep the things that they said. Jesus himself said, you put all these restrictions on these different people and all these laws and burdens on them, and yet you do not lift one finger to do any of them. Hypocrites. And they were condemning people. That's what they lived for. They thought their relationship with God was based upon how many sacrifices they can get everyone in the world around them to do. Because the more sacrifices they did, the more pleased God will be. Now, that's one way of looking at this. The Pharisees invented ways for people to be wrong. And this invention forced others to rely on those sacrifices in order to be right. The information that they needed for the sacrifice. And it made them rely on the priests even more, even though they may not be guilty of anything at all. It still made this relationship all about sacrifices. The emphasis should be on helping people to learn to be loyal to the commandments of God. That's not what they taught. Instead, they invented ways to produce guilt, as if humanity's purpose was to make sacrifices. Now, this is really getting to the heart of it. Their idea of what humans were supposed to be doing: we are alive so we can make sacrifices to our God. That was their mindset. And the more sacrifices they can convince you to make, the more that proved that you were loyal to God. That's not the way it works, though, is it? And this is where Jesus had a problem. Or they had a problem with Jesus. Humanity's purpose is loving kindness toward God, not sacrifice. That's hard for some of us to accept. My role on earth is not to make sacrifices. My role on earth is to love God with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. If you look at the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, 13, and 14, he says that very thing. Now, he says that we love God and we keep his commandments because there is a judgment coming. So there is still a sense in which we have to have sacrifices. Not speaking against sacrifices at all. But my life does not revolve around the sacrifices and the guilt and the problems and the difficulties that come because of sin. My life revolves around how I interact with God. What am I doing for him? How deep into the heart, in my heart, has this word penetrated? What does this relationship between me and God mean? And this is a very personal thing. And just because false teachers have talked about personal relationships and how they've abused that does not mean that the Bible doesn't teach about personal relationship with God. We are taught that over and over and over. God desires our loving kindness, not sacrifice. So in application, let's think about this. We need to help people learn to be loyal to God. We ourselves need to be loyal to God. But we need to help other people. That should be our primary focus in helping people. We need to help people learn about sin because it keeps them away from God. We need to help people learn how to pursue God. And I've said so many times, and I hope that you don't think because I say all these things that I think you're doing it wrong. I'm saying all these because we all need reminders of this. Paul didn't just say put off. He also said put on. It's not enough to put away the things of sin in the world. We also have to put on the attributes of God. So we need to help people pursue that. Also, we need to think about, we have an emphasis on the loyalty toward God and hearts that are loyal to God, they will give up the worldly things that are around them as they learn better. We can have two ways of looking at this. We can have an emphasis on guilt, or we can have an emphasis on grace, loving kindness toward God. And both of those, really, you're going to pursue things in the same way. You're going to have the same kind of techniques when you're studying with other people. You may have the same questions, but they're going to have very, very different results. And Jesus wanted them to understand this is the difference between what they believed, what they were doing, and what Hosea said, "I desire mercy, not sacrifice." We need to choose that. We need to choose to be loyal to God. We need to choose to love God with our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And as we do this, we will continue to work on the things and the areas where we have trouble and problems, but that is not our central focus. Our central focus is upon God. We don't need to get those confused. So this morning, I hope that you've, it's really not that difficult, but sometimes we complicate things, don't we? Maybe you realize that you're not really looking to God for help. Maybe you feel like you're just trying to check boxes. Or maybe you realize that you're lost and in sin. You need Jesus. The only way you can come to God is through him. So if you need to be baptized and come back to God, we want to welcome you to do that. If you want to be identified here as a member, we'd welcome you to be a part of this congregation here. All we're trying to do is grow and be better, have a better relationship with each other and with God first. If there's anything we can do, please, once you come, as we stand and sing.